Hearts open wide as we cry. We lift you high. We lift you high. Hands up, hearts open wide as the sky. Lord, we lift your name high. Hands up, hands up. Hearts open wide as the sky. We lift you high.
We lift you high. We lift you high.
Hands up, hearts open wide as the sky. Lord, we lift.
Lord, we lift your name high.
Oh, let all other names fade away. Oh, let all the other names fade away. Until there's only you, let all the other names fade away. Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place. All the other names fade away.
All the other names fade away.
Until there's only you.
All the other names fade away.
Jesus, take
your place.
Jesus, take your place. Hands up, hearts open wide. Hands up, hearts open. Wide.
We lift your name.
We lift you high.
We lift you high.
Hands up.
Hands up.
Hearts open wide as the sky.
Lord, we lift your name high.
Let all the other names,
let all the other names fade.
Let all the other names fade.
Let all the other names fade away.
Until there's only you.
Until there's only you.
Let all the other
names fade away.
Jesus, take your place.
Jesus, take your place.
Jesus, take your place.
Jesus, take your place.
Let all the other names fade away. Let all the other names fade away.
Jesus, take your place.
Jesus, take your place.
Jesus, take your place.
And the earth declares your wisdom, O God. And our hearts are open wide to worship you. There is no one that's greater, no one that's stronger than you. You are high and lifted. train of your throne. It fills the temple with glory. Jesus, take.
Jesus, take your place. Jesus, take your place.
Jesus, take your place.
Jesus, take your place.
Oh.
Jesus, take your place.
Consuming fire. Consuming fire. Burn it away. Burn it away, consuming fire, consuming fire, burn it away, everything that's not like you, burn it away, consuming fire, consuming
fire,
we want to be more like you,
consuming,
burn it away. Burn it away, burn it away, make us more like you, consuming fire. Presence. Oh, 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 oh,
oh.
Hallelujah. Arise, O God, arise, O God. Your presence is awesome. Your presence is wonderful. Shekinah glory, fill this temple. To worship you, I live.
To worship.
Do you realize this is our first fruit of worship on today for the rest of the year? To worship. to worship you. You are my desire to worship you, my live. To worship you. Worship you, I live.
To worship you, I live. To
worship you, I live. To worship you. Oh. This is beautiful. We esteem you. So swell among us. So swell among us. So swell among us. Feel the atmosphere. So swell among us. So swell among us. Yeah, make yourself enlarged. Oh, and feel the atmosphere. Swell among us. Stretch out yourself in this place with your wings of love and fly among us. Feel the atmosphere swinging among us. Yeah, swell among. We need your presence. We need your glory. Here we come in your presence. Feel the end. Swell among us. Your kingdom dwells on the inside of us. So make yourself enlarged on the inside of us. Where there's healing, where there's joy. Feel the atmosphere. So swell among us. Swell among us. Swell among us. Swell among us and feel the atmosphere. Swell among us. And even as the priests begin to worship, the Bible says that the glory of the Lord filled the temple where they couldn't even minister. Feel the atmosphere. Y'all keep singing. Swell among us. So our desire is for you to feel this place. And we know that you will draw all men unto you. Feel this atmosphere. Swell among us. Swell among us. Swell among us. Swell among us. And feel the atmosphere. Oh, 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 oh. Just one more time. Oh, 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 oh.
Father, we bless you. We thank you. We honor you. God, we give you this day. We surrender everything. To take any of the past into today. And Father, we declare and we believe that 2016 has expired and that 2017 has begun. And Father, we thank you for your grace and your mercy and your love. We're expecting, God, something marvelous. You said where two or three are gathered in your name, there you are in the midst of them. And so, God, we ask that your presence swell up in this place. We deplete ourselves of us. And we ask that you would come and fill this place, fill this temple. Fill this place with your grace and your presence, not just this building, but fill our souls in Jesus' name. Give us a fresh start, not just spiritually, but something that has to be renewed in the spirit of our minds, that we start fresh, that we know that you've started things spiritually, but God, the mind is slow to react. And sometimes it's antagonistic. And so, Father, I ask, let a word come forth that will regenerate our thinking, that will cause us to move forward in spite of who's not moving forward, that we'll move forward in the things of God that you called and spoke to our hearts individually, and you called us by name. And so, God, I ask in Jesus' name that there is a newness and a freshness in our thinking capacity, that we change the pattern of our thoughts to worship you, to honor you, to get this body moving and our eyes reacting and our ears responsive in Jesus' name, and our mouths begin to speak forth words that begin to be generated from our hearts, words that will change conditions immediately. Father, in Jesus' name, we honor you, we thank you, we bless you, and we give you glory and we give you honor. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Reach around and find somebody to embrace and hug. Glory to God. Glory to God. Ushers, just put everybody in the center part. Glory to God. Man. Turn these lights on. Glory to God. Man, glory to God. You can be seated. We're going to go ahead. They're going to play these announcements, and then I'm going to delve deep into, go deep into this word so that God can cause a regeneration.
This changes everything. And we believe God's love can change.
Hey, what's
our
up, man?
Past can change.
Oh, yeah,
our
yeah,
present,
I can talk. What's up?
And can change.
Don't be this guy.
Hi. We've all seen this before. A beautiful service interrupted by an annoying distraction. So, here's a few tips on things to avoid during the service. During the service, you'll more than likely want to take out your phone for various reasons. Just remember to turn your display light on low in an effort not to distract those around you. Your little bundles of joy are cute and precious, except when Precious decides to throw a tantrum. Please escort your crying child to one of the various age-appropriate areas on campus. It's fun to sit next to friends and family during the service.
Hey, look at this picture I took.
We ask that you please respect those around you so that everyone can listen to the message distraction-free. And last but certainly not least, we know you might feel inclined to head towards the parking lot towards the end of a service. As a better and more practical approach, we ask that you please remain seated till the very end of the service Really? Really, guys? Right when I'm talking about it? Okay, great. That's great. Thanks.
ECCM family, 2017 marks over 40 years for our overseer, Bishop Dr. Michael Brown. Stay connected and watch out for emails and additional correspondence for details.
Let's start the year by making a difference and impacting our city. The entire month of January is Visitors Drive Month. Every service this month, bring your family, friends, neighbors, and co-workers. It is our desire to fulfill our mandate by God to make disciples of all men, become an architect of kingdom building as God impact our city through us. Monday, January the 2nd at 7 o'clock p.m. will be our first corporate prayer of the year. Join us as we corporately intercede and seek the heart of God. You do not want to miss this powerful time of intercession. Are you ready to shatter every financial ceiling in your life and experience the financial freedom you desire? Then Sunday, March the 5th, is the moment you have been waiting for. This day, we will celebrate and give to God our $1,000 Millennium Breakthrough Offering. Let's take on the nature of God and be a giver. This will be a moment like none other. Get ready to delve into a deeper relationship with God during the Outpouring, a week of spiritual fathers scheduled for Wednesday, March the 15th through Friday, March the 17th. Be impacted by over 160 years of ministry with our guest speakers, Bishop Gilbert Coleman, Bishop Carl Alexander, and Dr. Mark Hamby, hosted by our own Bishop Dr. Michael Brown. Be sure to make plans to attend this today. This is a time for all saints, which is sure to catapult you into a deeper relationship with God.
Okay, so this is you, moving through life, no worries, no problems, then out of the blue, bam, you get hijacked. I'm not talking about planes, or cars, or boats, and I sure ain't talking about one of these things. No, I'm talking about hijacking a life, your life. I'm talking about you getting taken places that you don't want to go. How's it happen? Simple. With surprise attacks from anger, lust, lies, bitterness, worry, and a critical attitude. When these guys show up, they take control. You're just along for the ride. These hijackers are always sneaking and lurking, ready in seconds to take complete control of your thoughts, your mouth, your actions, even your future. And can you say collateral damage? Because I'll tell you who can. Your spouse, your kids, your friends, your family, they all get caught in the crossfire. Not even Mittens is safe. Simple conversation explodes in rage. Skadoosh, hijacked by anger. A little flirting turns into cheating. Bam, hijacked by lust. You're too afraid to face the truth? Boom, you've just been hijacked by lies. When you can't forgive and you won't forget, ka-ching, hijacked by bitterness. When the near and distant future ties your stomach in knots, bingo, hijacked by worry. And if you can't ever think of something nice to say, hello, a critical attitude is in charge, my friend. Is this what you wanted? Is this where you always dreamed your life would be? I'm guessing no. And unless you want to spend your life as a hostage, I suggest you step up and take charge. You gotta arm yourself with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Because that is some armor-plated badness, my friend. That's the big guns. We're talking the spiritual version of Chuck Norris standing outside your door ready to take down anything trying to jack you up. So calm down, open up, listen in, and face the truth. It's time to put yourself back in the driver's seat of life. Never again be hijacked. What's holding you captive?
This concludes CJC Church Announcements. Please enjoy the rest of the service.
Praise God. That is reality. And let me tell you, things have got to begin to change. This is a new year. And it is different when you go into something. You can't go in with the mindset that everything is the norm or as usual. You'll miss out on everything that God is doing. And so this is something we have to make an adjustment with. You got to make an adjustment in your heart. We have to hit the ground running with what God wants from us. And I can tell you, there is a large amount of apathy looming in the hearts and the minds of many of God's people. And I'm going to tell you one of the reasons why. When you're slow at doing stuff yourself, have you ever gone to work and it seemed like the atmosphere at work was somewhat mundane? It was just slow and da-da-da. But it wasn't the energy in the place, it was the energy in your own life. If you lack energy, everything around you will lack it. And so if you come in to the atmosphere of God as if we're here one more time, da 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 da, rest assured that God will not show up on your behalf. And you're gonna miss what it is that God has for you. Corporately, what God desires is to make change, drastic change. Some change can be too drastic for some, while for others, they're just ill-prepared for it. I expect for God to do something. I cannot look at conditions. This is the first Sunday of the year. I remember when God spoke to me once when I was a young man, and he told me to start praying and to have a prayer service. And he said, go in, set the time, and I did all of that. And then I went and invited everybody to come. I wanted everybody to come to prayer. And when I invited one person, everybody was like, oh, sure, I'm coming. Oh, yeah, I'll be there. And no one showed up. It reminded me of the scripture where Jesus said, gave the example of people inviting others to the wedding. And some said, I can't be there, I just got married. Or, hey, my oxen, I got to prove my oxen that day. And it went through one excuse after another one. And the Bible says, and they all begin to make excuses. When you're good for making excuses, you're rarely good for making anything else. You won't create the kind of change that God wants you to enter into. So when you're subject to environments instead of creating a change in an environment, then you become one who blends in to the environment or the culture or whatever is happening. And you, again, you miss what God is doing. God is never moved by conditions. He's never moved by how many are there, who's excited or who's not excited. He's looking for a heart who is trusting in him, who is depending on him for a dramatic change and saying, God, I don't know what you're doing, but I'm expecting change to happen. Some of you are looking for change as if you're saying in your mind, hey, just because I woke up, it's going to be different. It's not going to be that way. How many of you want to know the truth? Amen. You're going to have to press into this thing. Just because God said to the children of Israel that you're going to go into the promised land, that did not come without opposition. The first thing you got to do is get over your own stuff. You got to get over all of your scheduling. Are you all listening to me? You got this schedule, that schedule, and then you got to do this. You got to take care of home, and then you got to do this, and you got to do that. You got to make calls and whatever it is. And then you're trying to fit God into the very end of your day. So instead of giving God the best of your day, you're giving God the less of your day. If that's you, just say ouch under your breath. Don't say anything else. You give God the least of your day, and then you're saying, now God, give us the best of yours. Doesn't work that way. God can set everything in the garden for you, and you can go in and miss everything that he has set in there for you to enjoy. And you go after the one thing that he says don't eat from. You get to enjoy everything else, but you can become so fixated on the one thing that you forget about everything that God has given you the authority to freely enjoy. When you begin to walk in the fruit of what God has for you, and I'm demonstrating this the best way I possibly can, your spirit can't be the only thing that changes. Something else has to change. Your thinking. Because if this is not aligned with this, then even if God put you in the midst of everything you can possibly dream of, you'll never see it that way. You'll always have an excuse for something else. Well, it wasn't quite this way. It wasn't quite the way I wanted it, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. You got to make a change up here. You got to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. Because I guarantee you that somebody woke up this morning after coming last night and said, we're going to be set on fire. We're going to church. And before they got going, good and dandy, I'm telling you, they got into an argument. They thought that, hey, everything would dissipate. The devil will never bother me again. The reason why he's there is because he knows that you haven't made the transition here yet. You made the transition here. That's God. You haven't made the transition here. That's you. You have to be renewed in the spirit of your mind. You got to change this peanut brain, because this brain is still caught up in what happened in 2016. It is still caught up in the norm of 2016. It is still caught up in the frustrations of 2016. It is still caught up in the bitterness of 2016. You got to get free so that you can experience this lavish, abundant blessing that God has for you and I in this year. Because this is a corporate thing. Now, individually, we can go in. But don't you want to see your brothers and sisters go in and see the kind of change that you know can possibly happen in their lives by you just being one of the ones that says, I'm rescheduling everything, and everything starts with God. And every time I walk into the house of God, I'm going in with my mind set like a flint. You know, every time you look at a football team, and how many of you are football fans? Glory to God. Baseball fans, basketball, any sport. You got to set. They know the game is already set. It's already scheduled. You go play the game. It's already scheduled that if you got up that day, you're going to be in the game of life. Period. It's already scheduled. You can't say, well, I don't want to play. You are alive. You're going to play. And you have an opponent, and his name is Satan, and he's not taking this thing lightly. For you, it's just a modest game. For him, it's eternity. He is trying his best to ensure that you never take seriously what God is doing, so therefore you'll forfeit the game and you'll forfeit the blessings of that day, then your next day, and your next day. And before you know it, you've given up all of your days in 2017, and it becomes miserable. And you'll say, well, where is God? And God will say to you, I did my part. What about yours? I did my part. You say, well, God, you said you've given me joy. Yeah, I've given you the joy. Now do yours. Well, what do I do? Leap for it. Did you know that's a scripture? Leap for joy. Now here, he is saying you got to do your part. Many of us are saying, well, God, what's my part? And here you are, God. I'm just praying, and I'm hoping that you will just do this. And God is saying, I've already done it. Do your part. Say something and give me something to work with. If you have the authority to decree a thing, decree it to this brain. Make this brain react to your spirit words. say something. Stop saying, here comes the problems again. That's not what you should be saying. Here comes the lack again. That's not what you should be saying. Here we go again. That's not what you should be saying. God has done his part spiritually. You have to do your part physically. When God multiplied the two fish and five loaves of bread, somebody had to give the two fish and five loaves of bread. God does miraculous. You do the natural. You have to give God something to work with. Are you listening to me? You want this year to be spectacular, right? Say amen. Yeah, you want it to be a change. You want to be a period of growth. You want to see growth in this ministry. You want to see growth in your life. Give God something to work with. Change the way you talk and the way you act. Stop carrying the weight of frustration every single day in your life and expecting God to change it for you. When God promised the children of Israel, and he said, I've heard your prayers. And of course, he answered our prayers. He said, I've heard your prayers. When he said that, and he spoke to them, he gave them some instructions to do, to follow through on. Because there are things you got to do to act out things. Are you listening to me? God told Moses to tell the people to put their clothes on. Act like you're going somewhere. Because after this Passover, you got to be dressed and ready to go. See, most of us are saying, well, if we're not leaving tonight, why do we have to just put our clothes on? Act like you're going somewhere, or you're going to be stuck in Egypt. You may not be dressed and prepared for where God wants you to go, and you're not wearing it. You're not wearing the right apparel. You're not, you don't have the appearance. Your mind is not quite fixated on what God has already said. You got to get ready for it. You got to change your attire. You got to change the way you act. You got to put on a certain face. And I don't care what it feels like. You got to wear it. You got to wear it like you're going somewhere. You got to dress for success. Dress for where you're going. Act like you, it's like if you want a promotion, dress like it. My wife and I, we were listening to Allen Iverson, and he was saying, I would love to work in the front office. See, somebody's laughing already. I would love to work in the office, front office of the 76ers. I was like, if you really want to work in this place, dress like and act like and speak like you want to work there before you get there. Because they're not going to hire you the way you are. I don't care how good you were for the team. It should have showed you that you weren't that good when they traded you. Are you hearing me? But see, this is what we're doing with God. Okay, God, I'm ready to go in. And as soon as we look at conditions around us, is it prepared? Is it ready, God? You know, are you going to do it? God is saying, I've already done it. Don't you know that if you can't see it here, it's hard for you to really experience it here? You got to change this brain so that your mind can line up with what God has placed in your spirit. You have an entire harvest and wonderland, a paradise in your spirit, but you mentally live like you're in the wilderness. You know why the children of Israel, a whole generation, died in the wilderness? When God put, remember, he says, he has put eternity in our hearts, but we live like we only got a few days. He's put eternity in our hearts. Catch this. The children of Israel, a whole generation, their mindset was still in slavery, in handouts, and instead of change, they saw that there was no hope for change. And so therefore, they chose to stay in a wilderness. Listen, by the way they acted. Now, what are you saying? How did they act? They murmured. They murmured in Egypt. They complained in Egypt. How do you complain when God gives you water in the wilderness? It's when this brain doesn't compute with this brain all the wondrous things that God has already provided for you. When you have the power to create such a change and see it. You remember when John, in the third chapter of John, Jesus said, except you're born again, you cannot enter the kingdom of God, and except you're born of the Spirit, and he says, you cannot see. You can't even see what you're entering into. Something must change. Look at your neighbor and say, something upstairs must change. Now I hear people say, well, I just can't fake it. Well, you better learn to fake it. Because Jesus said, if you believe that you received, that means act like you got it, even though it's not there in the physical. You got to believe it's there. You got to act like it. If you see a wonderful kitchen and your kitchen renovated, you got to go in your kitchen and look at that old stove and say, I thank God for this wonderful, unique computer or a control at punch button, you know. All this, you got to see it and act like it. Why would God bring into fruition? Why would he bring the supernatural into the natural when you can't adapt to what you see in the spirit? You got to change your thinking. You have to. 2017 is one of those years. It's a year that God says we shall abound. Now, in the book of Proverbs, I believe it's the 28th chapter, it says, he says, plain and simple, the faithful shall abound. The faithful shall abound. This is the year that the faithful shall abound. Are you faithful? Now, some people can't honestly say it because their schedule is too... they're too filled with their own schedule. God doesn't have room in their schedule. They put God on the tail end. When you put God first and throughout, so that whatever God wants in the midst of whatever you scheduled, then you can say, I'm being faithful. You got to be faithful with time. You got to be faithful with resources, time, talent, and treasure. You got to be faithful with those three things. You got to be faithful by giving them your life. You got to be faithful. You can't say, it's like, and I started off talking about the football team. You can't say, hey, you know, we're going out there, and you know there's a team. You're playing the Patriots. The Patriots just have one of those teams that they're, you don't want to admit it, but they're just good. They got fundamentals down packed. They got a quarterback who is seasoned and able to throw and move out of the pocket, but he's slow as molasses. But it's a good team. And you got the other team over here. They're talented, man, but they don't have much discipline. they can run and speed out, man, but they don't know the routes. When they should go right, they go left. When they should go left, they go straight. So when the quarterback is throwing it to a spot, they're over here. And then you ever seen or played with someone and they act like, what's going on? Did you look at the play, the playbook? If I said Jack's quarterback slam Georgia back, that's the play. It will sound like Greek to some people who don't know football or isn't aware of the play. But the people on the team should know it. Now, when you're in the huddle and the guy who the play is called for says, now, what do I do on that one? It's like, change the play. Do an audible. Audible. You ever see baseball, the guy's on first base and he's giving signals? You think he's just scratching his butt? He's giving signals. He's giving signals because he says to those who are on the team, this is Team CJC. Change. Get ready. You're thinking, what is he doing? Why is he so, you know? And you're seeing the guy looking at the coach. And the guy said, what's that signal? I'm just scratching my butt. There are signals, and God can call an audible. But you got to learn to call an audible because you got the ball. Life is about this thing that we got to understand that things have got to change mentally. When they go out there, I remember, what's his name, Mo? Not Ray Rice because that's the wrong one. Ray Allen from the Baltimore Ravens. Ray Lewis. He would have his thing ready. He knows he's going up against his rival, the Pittsburgh Steelers. And there was a year the Pittsburgh Steelers just had their number. They just didn't win against them that year. But he went out every time, went through his steps. And man, next thing you know, he comes out, he says he's hurt. He said something, and I love his testimony. He said, I wasn't the fastest. He said, when you get to the professional level, he said, everybody is an All-American. You see, when you're in high school, All-American, you're good. You're in college, He said, but when you get to the pros, everybody's up there on that level. So you find out where your skill levels are, and when you're not quite there, you got to change this. When you can't run as fast as the other guy, you got to learn to cut off with angles. Mentally, you got to start adjusting when you don't fit the billing and all of your talent and everything isn't there that matches up with the guy who is so much faster than you. One thing that makes all the difference is how you see it in your head, the way you think of it. Now, people can talk about a Michael Jordan, or they can even talk about a LeBron James, which I'm not personally a LeBron James fan, but I like him. My wife likes him, but she likes him more than I do, but I'm not a LeBron James fan. I just want to make sure y'all know that he'll never reach the status of Jordan. I just want to let you know. Amen. Like Jordan said, when they asked, how does it feel when you won, when you gone up in the game seven? He said, I've never made it to a game seven. I've always won either in six or less. And I won the MVP in every one of those. and we won every time we went. But anyway, just want to make sure y'all know it, because I know some of you are LeBron James fans. But what did he do during that last game that they played against Golden State? No one can deny the drive that had to happen. You know his body is worn. He's tired. He's got to press a little bit more than everybody else. And here, you got to want it more than everybody else, even on your own team. Because contrary to popular belief, if he had not blocked that shot, which he is a master at doing, see, that's how the devil is. He comes up real fast behind you and makes you think, and he's running out like on his toes so you can't hear him, and you just want to lay it up passively. And LeBron is like, boom! Yes, he is. You got to respect that. You got to respect that this guy had the fortitude to say, I'm the only one that's going to outrun this guy. He was coming from midcourt, and he picked up his speed. He knew this was our last chance, or we're going to lose the championship. And he did it. It wasn't supernatural. It was natural. He changed his thinking and adjusted. When you think, well, man, I've already reached this plateau, you can go a little higher. This is why I think if you change, and I know, if you'll just change the way you think, and I mean change from the standpoint of stop letting conditions dictate to you. Stop letting someone tell you that something cannot be done when God said, you can do it. Who has the last word? God has the last. Don't you believe him? You know, if we believe that God will fill this place, do you honestly think that he's just going to just, and all the thousands of people are going to come in? No. He's going to look for every single thing that he could use that you will put into play. Take your energy, take your strength, take your ability, and he's going to enhance it and give you the ability to do something that you've never done before and was incapable of doing it at any other time. He's going to literally expand your ability to reach people. He said, I'll give you the nations. When you want something done, you want to see change in the finances. You're not just going to get up and all of a sudden all your bills are dismissed. I know you'll love that, won't you? In fact, I can say it and we'll all be, glory to God. Yeah. But the reality is, it's not going to happen that way. If it happens, it's like one out of a million. And right now, you are on the very low part of that million. So if it's not going to happen that way, what is God looking for it and how it should happen? You got to learn how to plant your seeds. You're going to have to learn to sow when conditions aren't favorable. You're going to have to learn to trust God, and then God will take the natural things, turn it around, and give you a supernatural harvest. God always uses something. Look at your neighbor and say, give God something to work with. Oh, you got to give him something to work with. If you want God to do all of what he said and bring this thing into fruition for you, you got to get settled that you got to do your part. You got to do your part. How many of you know you can have the mindset that, and I'm just going to be very upfront with y'all. Can we be that way? You can have the mindset, man, I'm coming into church. I'm ready. I'm fired up. And you come in, and everybody else is looking at you. What you so excited about? It's Sunday. Imagine how the praise and worship people have to fight through stuff. Any praise and worship people understand what I'm talking about? Imagine those who really love God and love this ministry, what they have to fight through mentally. You got to combat when people are dragging their foot coming in. They're like zombies. Is it worship time? Is it praise time? And you're like, come on, go, go, go. And they're like, you don't know the enemy uses you. You honestly don't know it. You don't know that the enemy hits you, that by the time you get up in the morning and he says, oh, you, I can't stop you from going to church because you're religious and going to church. But he said, but I can change the mindset so when you get there, you'll put a damper on the service. You'll make them have to fight through stuff. In other words, you'll create challenges without knowing it. That's why when we pray for stuff, you got to ask the Spirit of God, how do I pray against certain things? Because there are things you don't know that you're combating against. And that's how it is. You want to know the truth, right? Imagine God, he's sitting up and he's ready for his people to worship. And he's like, man, I can hardly wait. Ooh, they just got up. I blessed them. I gave them life, health, and strength. I gave them breakfast. Now look at them. They're too full to come in here and worship. And God says, okay, let me put this in the heart of the musicians and let them get excited. And I'm going to put this thought in one of the sisters, and she's going to remember all of what I did. And she starts crying, and people are like, what is she crying for? This is why if this doesn't change, you'll never experience whatever he put in this. Here, I got all the love in my heart for my wife, don't I? Just like you do. And for you, God has shed the love of God in my heart for his people. It's every single person. It's in his word. I have more than enough love to love you. But if I can't get over this and how you may have looked at me, and how you treated me, and the things you said to me, I'll never experience what God put in me. Never. Even though I have that love. And you know what's going to happen? He's going to hold you accountable in the day of judgment. He's going to hold you accountable for everything he gave you. Case in point. Jesus gave an example of three men, and he gave them talents. He gave them money. He gave them ability to do things. He gave one talent, gave five to one man. He gave two to another one, and he gave one to another man. Now, he gave them their talent based on what? Thank you. That means if you got something, you can produce something. Yeah, if you have something, you can produce something. And so he says, here, you got five, you got two, and you got one. Then he goes off, comes back after a number of years, and he's looking for something. What is he looking for? Yeah. And there's another word called profit. Now, he expects for you to live off of what he gave you, that you would make enough to live off of that, because some of that is to take care of you while you're doing the job to increase his wealth. Amen. You may call it commission. God gives us 90% commission. Where do you get that? 90% commission, and he doesn't recall it. Amen. He gives you this. He says, here's your ability. You have the ability to produce. How do I know? I have something. He gave it to me. How much do you have in you? A heck of a lot. So he comes back and he goes to the man that has five and he says, look, I have five and I produce five more. And he says, come and enter into the joy or the overflow. You've been faithful over a few things. I'm going to make you ruler over many. You impressed me with what you did. You produced twice as much as what I placed in you and what I gave to you. And the man says, hey, thank you. Walks right in. Here comes the next man. The next man had two. He's not complaining that he didn't get five. He's not complaining that he didn't have enough. But what does he do? How many does he produce? Two more. Does God get on him? No, because he's done what was right by at least producing what he had. He duplicated what he had. So he got two more. And the same words come into the overflow. You want to go into the overflow, right? The overflow that was already prepared for you. It's already prepared because God gave you the ability, but it's your choice to do something with it. Now, here comes the one with one. He probably was hiding out, and Jesus had to find him. You know, he didn't want to have to show up. He felt like it was too much pressure on him. So he shows up, and he says, wait one moment. And he pulls his stuff out, gets the dust off of it. The talent was in a handkerchief. He said, here. And he said, imagine somebody's giving you something back in what they think is the same condition that he gave it to you in. And you think you're impressing them. So what do? You say things, you say more than all the other two. You have a whole paragraph of words. You said here, I knew you were a hard man. And you like to reap where you have not sown and sow where you have not reaped. So I went and I hid your talent. So at least if I came back and didn't produce anything, at least you'll get your one back. And what did Jesus say? What is the opposite of profit? Unprofitable. He said, take that unprofitable servant and throw his butt out into outer darkness where there will be gnashing of teeth, weeping and gnashing of teeth. He was saying, dare you insult me? You mean to tell me I went through all of this to give you a promised land and you don't want to go in because of some giants over there? As if I can't take care of your giants for you? Did I not take care of Egypt? Did I not take care of Pharaoh, mighty Pharaoh? And his army, and drowned all of them in the Red Sea. Did I not do that? And you're so caught up with neglecting the gift that I have for you? He said, I swore. Some of us will say, I swore on my mama's grave. No, don't do that. He said, I swore, God said, I swore that you will never enter my rest. The promised land was there. The promised land wasn't here. The promised land never came, got it here. They let conditions dictate how they would see what God would do for them, what they would see, how they would see it. You got to ask God to help you to change the way you think. And as a body, we have to say, God, change the overall thought process of our body, of this church, so that we can know we can make a difference. Jesus chose 12 men. Just 12 men, not 1,000, not 2,000. He didn't say, man, I'm trying to build a 10,000 a group. No, he just said, I just 12. One of them was a devil, one was a doubter. He really had, one that was gung-ho for him. He just had some discipline problems. He had another one that was too young. He had another one, James, seemed to be pretty balanced. But imagine, look at his resource. Look at what he had to work with. And he said, come, and I want to change the world with you. I'm going to change the world. I'm going to change the way people think based on what I'm going to do with you. And I'm going to turn you from fishers of fish to fishers of men. You're going to be great leaders. I'm going to impact your life to the degree that everything you do and say will last for an eternity. And then here's the kicker on this. They didn't know this, but they had to have some clue beyond the mindset of just sitting in authority. They had to have some clue other than the natural that there would be a place in eternity for them to be seated. Because they argued, when you get into your kingdom, even the mother of John or James came, the two brothers of thunder rather, came and said to Jesus, now I'm wondering, my sons are with you, can they get either seat on your left or your right side when you go? Jesus said, it's not mine to give. He didn't refute, he just said, it's not mine to give. That belongs to the Father. But they didn't realize that they would be, for throughout eternity, 12, end up being 12 of the 24 elders that would flank the seat of God throughout eternity. You can't possibly imagine the impact and the inroads that you can make from this place to that place. You gotta get turned on. You gotta get turned on. You gotta change. You gotta force your brain by doing this, casting down every thought and imagination that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, pulling it into captivity. You gotta get so angry, I refuse to surrender and give in to that thought. I know that God's got a plan, and I'm working God's plan. What's God's plan? I don't know. I just gotta work it. How do you know you're working it if you don't know? The good thing, I'm obeying what he tells me to do. You don't know the overall scheme of a football coach when they're going out on the field. Every player watches certain things against their opponent in their area, what area they have to take care of. They can't be watching the quarterback in some of those cases unless that's part of their job. You know, it's going to be hard enough for you to deal with the one that's in front of you, dealing with a Beckham, that little just fast rat that just keeps running around. You're going to have to deal with him. There are certain things you just got to know that you don't have all the ability, and it doesn't matter. You just have to learn how to use what you have. Do you have enough? It starts with your worship. Stop dragging in here like a zombie. It starts with the way you think. Stop getting up in the morning and saying, oh God, one of those mornings. Look at the, especially when you don't see the sun shining. You know how many people are affected when the sun doesn't shine? Are y'all talking to me? People are terribly affected when the sun doesn't shine. It's like, oh my God, this is, oh man, one of those dreary days. How do you know? Because the sun isn't shining? Who told you the sun wasn't shining? The sun is always shining. We just like to say, man, the sun isn't shining. Oh, yes, it is. It shines at night. It shines during the day. It shines 24/7. The sun shines all the time. So stop saying the sun isn't shining. Stop saying God has not brought you into the wealthy place. Stop saying that God has not blessed you yet. Stop saying I don't feel like we're going into 2017. Stop saying stuff that cripples you. How many times are you going to say, God, you know I said, Lord, I'm going to change this year. I said it last year. I said I'm going to come in. I'm going to worship. But God, just help me. When are you just going to do? Do you honestly think God is going to say, okay, I'm going to give you this supernatural ability. Get ready for it. You ready? Bam! And you're going to say, I feel it. I'm ready to go now. How many of you know, he says, if you lack wisdom, ask him. And what did he say? He'll give to you how? Baby, you know that's a lot of wisdom. Now, you'll say, well, where is it? You think the wisdom comes with a certificate. Man, you're not going to get a certificate. You're not going to get a medallion around your neck that resembles a heart. It's not going to work that way. You pray for bravery. God says, okay, you got it. Then you think that you have to show your bravery by killing a roach. God is like, oh, no, that doesn't even test what I've placed in you. No, this is your opponent here. And here comes this big old Goliath-looking dog. Or here comes this thing down the street, and you're saying, oh, I have authority over all the animals on the earth. And God says, yes, you do. Now here comes a dog while you're walking. And come on, are you listening to me? You're saying, God, give me wisdom. And God says, yep. And you're saying, praise God. God, I thank you, Lord. You're put into the most complex situation. And you're saying, I've never done this before. What did you just ask for? If you ask for wisdom, think it out. He'll give you the answer. You'll start seeing the formula, the way it's put together. Now it won't start if you don't start thinking. It won't come to you if you're not thinking. You see, you think that you don't have to think. It's just going to be like, I'm going to put it together now. No, you're going to have to sit down. Okay, read the instructions. Okay, troubleshoot. It's going to get frustrating. Okay, I did this. I did that. Have you ever read instructions and the instructions weren't clear? But needless to say, it wasn't clear in your mind. you miss things in reading it. And when you go back and you read it again, and you read it again, wisdom. Wisdom. Wisdom has tremendous patience. When you don't have it, it's like, man, this thing don't work. It works. You got to learn how to work it. Look at your neighbor and say, I'm getting something, and I'm changing my brain. You catching it now? Are you getting this? I think we just got to hit fundamentals. We just got to hit fundamentals. Because if we're going to hit the ground running, that means basketball. If you are the guard, and Charles, the natural guy that may be 6'6", he is the center. You have a guard. You have another guard. They're good with the ball. They can pressure stuff. They know how to defend. They know how to get around you when they have the ball. And you got the power forward. And you got these people in place. And they're waiting when the guy throws in the ball that the center doesn't start saying, I'm going to show them I can be a guard too. And he's running down court, dribbling the ball this high because he's this tall. Are you listening to me? All the other guards are this short. And he thinks he can just keep dribbling, fake him out. The ball is way up here. That little guy just gets the ball down here, steals it, and everybody's on the bench. And then the big center is like, hey, where's my man? I'm not putting you on the spot. It just ticks me off when you see, man, my God, we were watching. It was a few seconds left. The Lakers was down by, what, one doggone point. It's 8 seconds left. They have to take the ball. That's a lifetime, man, to get the ball. He's bringing the ball up real slow. It's like, and he's like, and he's doing this. Like, and everybody, even the announcer, the clock is ticking. Everybody, Matthew, clock is ticking. Everybody's shouting, man. My mama was shouting, the clock is ticking. And he's coming down, trying to fake him out. He's way behind the three-point line. Needless to say, how much of that rim did he miss? Have you ever just been at home just, I'm going to bed? <You can't. laughs> You're like, man, you are a guard. Assist. Make an assist. Push it down. Throw it off to somebody fast. Give it to the man who is the center who may have a possible better shot inside. We're a team. There are things that God gives us because we are a team. It's when you start thinking, I can do this. You start getting jealous because this guy is getting more play, or this guy is getting more media time, and this guy has all the girls. And do your part. You've got incredible ability to make something work, like filling this place. But if you don't grow spiritually, if you don't grow with God, you can't grow with the team. It's one body. God wants all of us to be a blessing one to another. He wants us to energize his church in the earth. We host his presence in the earth. He doesn't want you, and you grieve the Spirit of God. Even as a youth, you know, you can grieve the Spirit of God by neglecting the importance of God's presence. I'm here to share with you this most important word. If we don't, it's like what the guy, can I say this, in the guy that said in the movie Any Given Sunday, if we don't pull ourselves together as a team, we will die as individuals. We are one body. I raised my hand, but then I got five individual fingers, or four fingers and a thumb. They all play an important part with this entire body. The entire body. The thumb says, I don't want to play anymore. I don't like what ability God has given me. So it's taken out of the picture. Put it back here. And so you still want to be the quarterback with a hand with no thumb. You got to get the ball like this and try to throw the ball. Like you can't get the velocity that you need. And who do you ultimately affect? The entire body. Like the guy, Russell, the whole team loses. How much ability do we have? We have every ability to accomplish everything that God has placed us on this planet for as a unit. You got to decide, first of all, to make God the king of this brain. And make your adjustments and honor God and believe what he says. You gotta not believe it only here. You gotta believe it here too. That's why he says, be renewed in the spirit of your, and all, if you really wanna put it in the right text, it means in your attitude. Change your funky attitude. Attitude is everything. Can you imagine being in the huddle? We have a chance to win. Man, we're not going to win. Man, it's not going to happen. Man, I don't think we can do it. Man, I just hope something happens. What do you want to do? Throw that joker overboard, man. Kill him. Make him fall down a flight of stairs or something. But you got to get rid of him. Did you know that's one of the things that Moses, God told Moses, to, look, if you got these naysayers, don't let them say anything and get in there. Because it'll pollute the whole. A little leaven leavens the whole doggone lump. Somebody, I don't know if it's going to happen. I don't know if we're going to make it. Oh, my God. I just hope we, people, the game may not be pretty. It may be that you've gone back and forth, lead changes throughout the game. You ended up going into a double overtime. You're so evenly matched. And you got the ball with the last 5 seconds left. No, let's make it three. 3 seconds left. Derek Fisher. I don't think it's enough time to put the ball. As soon as he touches, he's going to have to throw it up. That's what your announcer says. You got all the naysayers. They're playing against San Antonio. Thank you, Jesus. Fisher gets the ball, just like they say. He don't have enough time to dribble. You don't. But you got enough time to throw it up. He got the ball. No, it was .03 on the clock, wasn't it? Thank you. Thank you. You looked at me. I feel you. Just don't be a guard. Anyway. He got the ball with .303 seconds, people. That's not enough. All he did was get it. See, thank you. And threw the ball up. It's in slow motion. It looks like it's on. Man, can you imagine? Your heart is pumping. It is boom, 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 boom. These are the Spurs. Mr. Fundamental. Everybody loves Mr. Fundamental. He just does everything so right. And the ball is going up. The other team is looking. Oh, we got this. He missed. And it goes in all net. And Fisher doesn't even stop. He just runs straight through to the locker room. In his mind, I don't want them to have a chance to recall and look at this on the thing. But the reality is, the win isn't always pretty. But when God gets you down there at .03 seconds, he says you can do it. Heaven is like this. Angels are standing. We are a spectacle to them. That's what the Bible says. And they're waiting. They're saying, man, okay, come on, come on, come on, come on. How do I know that happens? Because when Jesus finished his trial in the wilderness, don't forget, angels were all around them. They could not interrupt. Jesus had to do this on his own faith. He had to combat the enemy while he was at his weakest point. He was drained because he had been fasting for 40 days. God, I don't have any more strength. God says, I know you don't. Just keep on pushing. And here you are. Jesus sits down. He's finished. The enemy leaves, and who comes? They're high-fiving. Jesus, you did it. Jesus is barely able to put his hand up. Wasn't pretty. I almost gave in. But I didn't. I didn't give in. And the angels ministered to him and strengthened him. That, beloved, is when the thrill of victory becomes so sweet. Everybody wants to win by 10. Everybody wants to win by 5. You want to win where you're not going down to the wire. Sometimes it's like that. You have to get down, go down to the wire. It tests the character in you. It stretches you. And when God sees us as a team, it stretches us. When we're depending on everybody to do their part. Amen. Father, we bless you. We thank you. We honor you, for this is the hour of greatness. We're changing immediately the way we think. Immediately. We're going to stand out instead of always fitting in. We're going to work with the team. And individually, we're going to work on growing ourselves in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. We're going to get into your word, God, so that we, when we come to the team and when we come to the table, we got something to bring to the table. We're going to believe you for things. We're going to believe you for increase, so that when we have to come to the team for giving, we've got something to give. We're going to believe you, God, for supernatural ability to pray and intercede and speak words into the hearts of people, so that when you fill our hearts, when we come to the table and we strategize, we got something to say. Every joint supplieth. Every joint supplieth. God, thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. We have a cloud of witnesses. Imagine a cloud of witnesses that have gone before us, and they're testifying to us that we can make it. Their victory is a testimony for us. When they went through the most horrific times, their names written in the hall of faith, they are a testimony that you too can make it. Noah and his sons are a testimony that we can build the ark without having any prior experience. David is a testimony that we can defeat our enemies even though we're outnumbered. We have a testimony that Ahab, who was once a harlot, became a significant part and took on a major role in the lineage of Jesus Christ, that we can make a difference. We got a cloud of witnesses that have gone before us, that have done incredible things, and they're saying to us, because they are alive, God is not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. They are alive, and they too, along with the angels, are just cheering you on. They're cheering you through that struggle in your marriage. They're cheering you on through that struggle in your finances. They're cheering you on when you're contemplating, should I tithe or should I not tithe? Should I give an offering? Should I break down and give something great, of great significance? They are cheering because you got this cloud of witnesses that have gone on before you. They're saying, you can do it. Look at what we've done. You can do it. Look at what we went through. You can go through it. Look at what we did as a team. You can make it. Father, we bless you. Now you put paradise in our hearts. It's up to us to put it in our minds. We renew our minds and we keep our mind on Jesus Christ. And you said you'll keep us in perfect peace. I am encouraged, not discouraged. I'm going to make a difference now, not tomorrow, because it's not promised. But right now, I can make a difference. I can make a difference in my giving. I can make a difference in my attendance. I can make a difference in my praying. I can make a difference in studying the word and growing. I can make a difference in speaking words to those who are discouraged. I can make a difference for lending my ear to someone who just needs someone to just bounce something off or just pour out of their hearts what they're troubled with. God, I can and I will. Say that, God, I can and I will. We are with Team Jesus. Team CJC is with Team Jesus. This is his plan. And I'm expecting the very strongest to the weakest, from the wealthiest to the poorest, to make a difference in God's work. God, I thank you and I bless you for people like Jamila, who gives her time. God, don't forget your labor of love. Don't forget her labor of love. Increase her, that her latter days is far greater than her former. Even when she went door to door, visiting first people who visited our church, first-time visitors, and she would have to get out of her car struggling, but she would go to that door faithfully. God, thank you. And I know that there are times she was tired, but you gave her strength. And you just said, one more, daughter, just do it one more time. And each time you gave her strength. Now, God, I'm praying as you minister to my heart, just like the young man in that movie, Hacksaw Ridge. True story. Even though he was a conscientious objector and just didn't believe that he should kill another human, it didn't dismiss the fact that he didn't believe, that he believed that he should make a difference. And when everyone left him on that battlefield, he was still there, pulling as many that were still alive, even at the risk of bullets being hurled towards him. And each time he would say, God, just one more. Give me one more, Lord. Give me one more. God, I'm praying that fervor is in our minds and our hearts. Just one more soul. Just one more soul. Give us one more soul. And when we get that soul, give us one more soul. And when we're tired, God, give us one more soul. And when we feel drained, just one more offering. Just one more offering, God. Just give us one more offering. Just bless us to make a difference in building your kingdom instead of tearing it down, expanding it instead of shrinking it, gathering instead of scattering. You said if we don't gather, we scatter. Father, we say yes to your will. And when we do that, you will cause our account to overflow. Because I heard God say, I am keeping a record of not everything you've just done, but every wrong that was done to you, every hurt that was done to you, every attack that was done to you, and I'm going to repay you. And I believe with all my heart that this is the year of repayment and this is the year of abounding. Just keep your heart and mind pierced on Jesus and be more ready to hear rather than to give the sacrifice of fools, for they consider not that they do evil. That you declare and make your vow and believe that vow unto God. That you're not making a New Year's resolution. You're making a vow to God, an oath, and you're asking God to give you strength to fulfill that oath, that vow that you're making. And the first part of that vow is, God, help me to give you my heart, all of it, God, so that you can always have my heart. And if you have my heart, show me how to give you my mind. So not one part of me belongs to me, when essentially I am owners of nothing. I'm just a steward of everything. I honor you and I thank you, God. And I mark this day and I say yes to you. If that's you, will you give him a resounding yes? If that's you.
Yes.
My time is no longer my time. Help us to redeem the time, for the days are evil. Bless us to work as a team, as one. And you said that they'll know that we're your disciples because we have love one for another. God, you told us to come out from the world, not to leave worldly people. They're the target, not only for us, but for the enemy. Let us populate heaven and depopulate hell. And we declare it in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Can you give Jesus a praise offering? Glory to God! If you have your offering envelope, I want you to make a seed that would mark something. That would be an indicator for something. That we're going to start up again the planting and watering, and that would mean that we get people to not volunteer but just commit to going out and knocking on the door of the people that came and just giving them something from the church. And I just had to mention you yesterday, Jamila. People that were, because she reminds me so much of the, not that she's old, but the old lady that God called this. She was young when God called her, and God said, I want you to go out on the streets and I want you to minister to those prostitutes. And she ended up doing it until she was 70-something years of age. And it was just one day, she said, God, I'm really tired. My body is not like it used to be. I'm older now. And God said, I know. I'm asking you to just go one more time for me. Those prostitutes out there waiting, they're waiting on you. They need you. And she would get up, bones cracking, struggle, get on her coat, and go down the skid road. And she would meet with those prostitutes and share the gospel with them. She seen many of them get saved, some that never got saved, but they heard a word. But let me tell you what God did, and I know. He will give you the greatest party. That everything that you've done in this lifetime for him, he will reward you so greatly, not just in the life to come, but in your latter days. And you'll find so many people are there to love you and to say thank you. And those, when you die, they'll meet you at the gate. And they'll remember you and they'll say, thank you for sharing the gospel with me. Because this game is the only game that winning matters throughout eternity. We ask God for the grace to do this work. And I know, Vanessa, I know you're not much older than I am. But you're just a blessing. But he calls you young because you're strong. And so I'm praying that God put a fire in your heart, man. That we're no longer going to sit back and see the work suffer and see our lives suffer and see our brothers and sisters suffer. We're going to get up and we're going to do something. We're going to do whatever it takes to inspire somebody, to encourage somebody. We're going to bring people to this work. We're going to pray for them. We're going to make a difference. And when does it start? Right now. Right now. If it wasn't for somebody when I got saved that said, tell that young man, we're going to invite him over to our house. And it was right across the street. And that lady became a spiritual mother to me. And I know I probably would not be here right now if I didn't have that connection. Because that fellowship meant the world to me. Because I didn't have family here. I was in the military, a young man. And they just... After a while, I felt so privileged because everybody was just fighting for me to come over. I was like, man, praise God. I got the pick of the litter to choose where I can go and eat and have fellowship. You don't know how good it is as a guy that's in the military. You don't have to go to the mess hall. The mess hall is not like it was when I was in the military. They call it the dining facility. Man, they literally slopped those mashed potatoes on your tray. It was a tray. Now y'all got plates. You know, we had a tray and it was metal. Sometimes it was like a wooden kind of plastic kind of, and they would just, how much you want? You want something? Ploop, potatoes. Nothing had flavor. You gotta put a lot of salt and pepper and stuff, man. The meat was never seasoned. But when they invited me, man, oh my God, just eating over their house. And they would say, Brother Brown, take your shoes off. You sure? I was so embarrassed. I had holy socks. But God said, be holy, not raggedy. But I had a family, and that made all the difference. People, I'm telling you the honest to God truth. That's why I'm here right now. That's why I'm pastoring. They became my family. This is my family. You all are more vital to me than my blood. Believe that. You are such a blessing to me. And I look forward to seeing all the things that God has honored your house to be blessed with. The favor is abundant. Glory to God. Stand to your feet with your seed. We put it in our right hand. God, we give you what's right and not what's left. We honor you. We bless you. We love you. And this offering associated with our seed, which is our tithe, but the offering, God, is symbolic of a breakthrough for something. We're sowing towards another soul. I'm believing that every seed is filled. I don't care how often we've got to confess it, but we're going to apply the faith and the action with our confession. And God, let it be with this marking as a symbol, God, of our faithfulness to you. We're believing for souls. We'll do the natural, God. But we need you to do the supernatural. We honor you and we thank you. Here am I, send me. In Jesus' name, thank you for my harvest. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Some of the ministers and elders would just start talking and sharing with you and fellowshipping with you. And then when we get visitors, don't look like we have. Do we have any first-time visitors here? I don't want to miss anybody. I don't see any first-time visitors. Glory to God. This is the first service of the year, and we're here. Don't be concerned about who's not here. Thank you, brother. You can come up here. But we're here, and we're making a difference. We're that 12. We're starting it off. Amen. Are you with Team Jesus? Team CJC? Glory to God. We say yes. We have a new visitor on the first, new member on the first day is presented to this individual. Deborah, can you come up here? And it is?
Sophia Judy.
Sophia Judy, come on up here. Hallelujah. God bless you, dear. She is originally from Haiti. So we got them coming from all over the world. Amen. It's time to get busy. Now, people, that makes a difference. I'm glad that happened on the first day. Glory to God. Let it mark the rest of these. Let it be so that we're giving out certificates on Wednesdays. We're just overflowing. People are just saying, can I get the class done? We're getting the class done, giving them the certificate, baptizing folk in Jesus' name. I forgot, is there baptism coming up and scheduled? We got to schedule a new baptism. We're scheduling that baptism before we even have anybody to sign up, because we're going to get some people that's going to be baptized. Amen? Glory to God. I love you all. I appreciate what you're doing. We're going to make a difference. Tomorrow is prayer, isn't it? We're going to make a difference. Glory to God. I'm encouraged, aren't you? Amen. What are you going to work on changing? Now, is the cup half empty or half full? Amen. Is the seats filled or emptied in here? Glory to God. We bless God. Am I missing anything? Y'all help me out. Yes. Yes. Oh, the people that the teachers for the Covenant Bonding course, Elder Sparkman needs to just share something very briefly with you. Since we don't have any visitors, we got refreshments in there. Hide my portion of the refreshments before these scavengers go in there, because they're going to get in there and say, oh my God, look! Go in there and enjoy yourself with whatever is over there. I don't know what Nail may have brought. I want to also say thank God for the people who sense the importance and the need to be back here for watch night. You went home and you made sure that you were at your home church for this transition. And I'm appreciative, because that shows it's in your heart. You do want this work to succeed. I love you all. Reach out and touch your neighbor's hand. Am I missing anything? You sure? Look at that person next to you and say, I really do love you. Tell the other person next to you. Team Jesus. My son, we were in the car, and what was that we chanted? Yeah. And we were saying game time, and my son said, we said, what time is it? He said, church time. I said, that's right. What time is it?
Church time.
What time is it?
Church time.
What time is it?
Ooh,
build it up and say Jesus. Ooh, Jesus! Go in the grace of God. I love you all. and go down.